Everybody to this session, which is being run by myself, Joanne Fillingham. I'm the Clinical Director of Allied Health Professions and Deputy Chief Allied Health Professions Officer at NHS Improvement, and my colleague here.
I'm Zoe Packman. I'm the Head of Professional Development at NHS Improvement.
So we have been given the title of Nursing and AHP Improvement, but actually what I want to talk to you today is about how the wider workforce, so the whole multidisciplinary team, is crucial in terms of being involved in improvement and change. And I'm going to provide some context to start off with, and then we're going to use a specific example of which Zoe has been leading within NHS Improvement about the Falls Collaborative. So why we've heard this morning, and it was quite heartwarming for me, for both Jim and Sonia talking about people and people being our greatest resource and asset, and ensuring that we engage with clinicians as a first point of call. I was lucky enough to be part of one of the ACT Academy's training sessions on transformational leadership for change. And actually what I've thought of over my career is thinking of change in terms of process versus people. Actually they had a different concept or metaphor for it. In terms of change, in terms of a metaphor as systems as machines versus systems as relationships. And actually when we think about change and improvement, it's really important to consider both of these metaphors in terms of improvement and change, both as systems as machines, so the processes, so the improvement methodology, and certainly the Falls Collaborative did that in terms of utilising a 30-60-90 methodology. But what is vital and crucially important is that we don't just consider process over considering people. So in making sure that we consider relationships and people as part of this process is so important. What we found historically is that the governance structures within provider organisations often are a risk of excluding certain professional groups from change or improvement processes. And we need to make sure in the future that this doesn't happen. And this is because of many things. The challenges that we've seen in the 5-year forward view, we need to make sure that the whole system and all professions are involved in change. But also we've got evidence to demonstrate that wider professional and multi-professional team makes a difference to patient care. So for example, in the NHS benchmarking intermediate care audit, year on year it's been demonstrated that using a validated outcome measure tool, that the outcomes for patients are far greater when there are a greater number of professions involved in an interdisciplinary team. And that's not numbers of people, that's different skill sets. So when there are a greater number of skill sets involved in an intermediate care team, then there are far greater outcomes for patients. That's why it's so important that we consider that wider multidisciplinary team. And so in doing that, we can build a much greater social energy. I don't know whether you've heard of this concept of Work Out Loud by John Steeper, which is the central to this illustration that's been done by Tan May Vora. I don't know whether anybody has read any of his blogs. I would urge you to go and do that. They're really quite inspirational in terms of his management and leadership journey. But Work Out Loud is a concept which is about capitalising on the wisdom of people and doing that in a traditional form of relationships, but also doing that in terms of sharing wisdom between people, both in traditional relationships, so face-to-face relationships, but also capitalising on the opportunity we've got with technology in terms of social media to really spread that at scale and pace. So what Tan May's done here in this illustration is to show how you work out loud, how to build that social energy. So it's about sharing internally and externally. It's about finding relevant people and content to share with those a shared purpose. It's about giving back, sharing, commenting and connecting people, and therefore making it part of your routine. And this slide was presented at one of the last four collaboratives events by Catherine Pereira from Helen Bevan's team about how important this is in terms of building that social energy and networks for sustainability of improvement. And so that comes on to this, which is the source data from Nick Milton, which is about social connection discussion is 14 times more effective than written word best practice database and toolkits. And certainly that is essential when you think of my initial point about processes versus people, and people being our greatest resource. And when you're talking about work out loud and sharing that wisdom, it's really important that we, in our improvement and change journeys, that we really build that momentum in terms of sharing and learning, not just face to face, but utilising technology. And I'll come back to that later on in this presentation. And so here is just some lovely pictures from the Falls Collaborative, which demonstrate some of that learning and networking. In the bottom left-hand corner is a picture taken from one of the national events that was put together on the 30, 60, 90 day journey. And the other three pictures are what pictures that have been happening locally that have been shared on social media. So you can see here how the role modelling, the leadership behaviours in terms of that networking, sharing, you can see the little feet there, that's about the steps on the next stage of the journey, is then shared and taken back to local organisations so that they can equally share their journey. So I'm going to hand over to Zoe now, who's going to tell you about how that then translates to the example in terms of the Falls Collaborative.
Thank you, Jo. So we thought what would be really useful for you today is if we shared a really specific example of how we've put this learning into practice. And I've been privileged enough since January of this year to be leading the Falls Collaborative with 19 trusts up and down the country who've been on a varying degrees of a journey, both in terms of their improvement, but also in terms of their Falls work. And this is a methodology that we've tried to utilise in our team quite a lot, which is that we bring together trusts who have been performing really well with the subject matter area, but also trusts who are perhaps struggling a little bit. And by that way, you move the good to great and the not quite so good to getting much better. And it really seems to work for us. So when we were thinking this year about what works programmes we were going to undertake, one of the stark facts that comes across is something that has just not been going away for a number of years, which is around falls, and particularly falls in hospital, and even more specifically, injurious falls in hospital. So we set up the Falls Collaborative with the aims that are identified there. But the most important thing for us, especially with myself and Joe working together, is about encouraging falls away from being about just a nursing issue to making it much more about a multidisciplinary focus, and really re-energising the falls prevention movement that was out there. There are an awful lot of falls practitioners. There are also a lot of people in organisations making a difference with falls, and we wanted to really energise and enhance that.
My name's Helen McGahn. I'm Head of Physiotherapy at North Cumbria University Hospitals NHS Trust, and also act as the Falls Champion for the Trust. We had the opportunity to be part of NHS Improvement's 90-day Falls Collaborative at the beginning of this year. I'm delighted to say we were selected and were one of 20 trusts that worked at improving our falls situation. Being part of the Falls Collaborative has really improved our falls situation. We had two wards that took part, and in our emergency admissions unit, they've had a 30% improvement in falls, and on a rehabilitation ward, we've had a 40% improvement in falls. In our first quarter this year, we've reduced falls by 19% across the whole of the organisation. So the way we went about this was the collaborative encouraged us to take our ward teams down to the initial event to learn about improvement methodologies. And it was that taking away the teams and giving them the time out to stop and think about how they could improve that really made the difference to the teams. So initially the Falls Collaborative encouraged us to map our current state. And I think that's something that we hadn't really ever done around falls within the organisation. So these two ward areas actually stopped and looked at the patient journey and the ward's daily activities and started to identify areas where the problems were. And then working together as part of a multidisciplinary team, they came up with solutions. The collaborative then got us to go back after a month and we shared our learning about the problem areas, and we worked with other trusts that have similar problems to work on opportunities to improve the situation. One of the most important parts of being part of the collaborative for our organisation is stopping and thinking and actually mapping and identifying where the problem is. So having that current state to work from. Then working as an MDT and actually getting the improvements from the ground up so that the staff in the area identify the problems and make the changes. And that's what's embedded the change and will give it longevity. So our future plans are to roll out the process throughout the organisation, moving to other wards that are having challenges around falls. And we will take the same approach. We will stop and think and map out current state. We may use some of the learning from the other ward areas, but we will support them to develop the processes they need to improve their situation.
So thank you. I was expecting the slide that said, let's hear from those involved, to come up before I had my speaker. So thank you very much to Helen from North Cumbria, who were one of the trusts that participated in our collaborative. And it was really important for us today, and we've got other examples as I talk, to have some of the providers here to share with you. But of course, it's always holiday season when you're trying to do these events and trying to get people. So I'm very grateful for Helen taking time out last week to share her story in a video. So as Helen described there in her talk, the first thing that we did was bring all of the trusts together and provide them with the tools. And that was a day that I don't think everybody enjoys as much as they think they will, because we do spend a lot of time talking about improvement methodology. But we do break that up by talking to them about some of the elements that Joe's been talking to you earlier on this morning, which is in terms of how you become a change agent, how you build that energy, how you identify roles and responsibilities, and how you adopt that into practice and garner that energy in order to move things forward. So it's really important on day zero that we undertake that. Then we send them away and ask them to do a process map. And there's always lots of groans in the room when you say to people, you need to do a process map. We know what happens when a patient has a fall. And then you see them rolling up that giant piece of brown paper with all those hundreds of stickies on it. And they think, gosh, it was an awful lot more complicated than we thought it was going to be. But we also encourage them to test small changes. And our philosophy is no change is a wasted change. Any kind of small change can make a really big difference. And certainly, I know that when I went up and did my visit in Cumbria, that the guys there had made some changes in one of their ward areas, and they were really excited and they were about to roll it out everywhere. And then they stopped and they thought, actually, this works really well in this ward area. We need to test that change in other ward areas before we move on. So it was really important to utilise that. The other thing that is really important is it's really great to garner that energy from the bottom up of the organisation, from those that are caring from the patients. But actually, what you need to be doing is getting this on the trust board agenda. And so part of the work that we do is working with executive colleagues as well to ensure that this becomes really part of the business of the organisation, not just seen as a project. So I'm just going to spend a couple of minutes just talking through a couple of examples here. So this is one of the poster presentations that we ask the teams to complete when they come back on day 30. And if you remember the slide from before, you will see that what we do is we put them in a room very much like this, although a lot larger because there's 120 of them, and get them to share the work that they have done. We got them to talk through what were their aims, what were they going to achieve in that first 30 days, and where are they going for that. So this example here is from Kent Community Hospital, and they had a really specific aim, which was around reducing avoidable falls harm in the community hospitals by 10% during the fiscal year that we're in. And one of the small changes that they made that has made a really big difference is that lovely upward trend there, which is around accurately taking lying and standing blood pressure. That small change has made a really big difference to a large number of patients for them, and has ensured that actually what they're doing is maintaining patient safety through use of their clinical knowledge. This is one of the examples from North Cumbria, and I'm afraid that their driver diagram hasn't come through as well. But this is, again, some of the small step changes that Helen was describing. And this was around looking at the staff in order to look at when did the falls happen, what were the contributing factors to those falls, and what kind of falls were they? And one of the things they noticed was is that falls were often happening in areas where they couldn't see the patients, where the patients weren't visible. And of course, the natural instinct then is to put all the patients on one-to-one care or think about some kind of close observation. But actually, they realised that you still need to encourage the patients to rehabilitate and to mobilise. So actually, that might not necessarily be the way forward. So they made lots of step changes. And certainly, I know this is right at the beginning of their journey, day 30, when I think they'd barely made any of their big changes. And actually, what they were already starting to see was a reduction in the number of falls. And certainly, it was great excitement when I was up there counting the days between the number of falls they'd had, and they were certainly rising. The second ward in North Cumbria that they used was an acute stroke and neuro rehabilitation ward, and it was a deliberate decision on the behalf of the organisation, because it was already a team that was a multidisciplinary team that were really used to working together in a multidisciplinary way. And it was already a team that knew where they wanted to go and wanted to make some changes. But they'd also had some changes in the team in that they had combined two clinical areas. Now, I thought over my career I'd seen all sorts of ward shapes and sizes, but that ward certainly gave me another eye-opener on how you can have these folk with their neuro-rehabilitation stroke unit on a lovely racetrack ward and those nurses and AHPs running around the ward looking for the patients. But again, just at 30 days, it already started to see, even though with the therapeutic intervention of encouraging the patients to mobilise, to still be active, they were already starting to see small changes. And one of the small changes they made, which, you know, when you just think about it, you think, how have we not noticed this before, was in their bathroom areas, the light switch and the call bell were behind the patient. So if a patient was in the toilet, sitting on the toilet, as you do, and they wanted any kind of help, to get to the call bell was actually a falls hazard in itself, because actually they were going to have to stand up and make a difference. They also had the light sensors in the room, which is all really well and good, because the companies come and they tell you put these light sensors on and the lights will come on as you go into the room. But what they actually forget is that some of these folk are a little bit slower on the toilet than some other folk. And so actually the lights were going off and these poor patients were sat there in the dark needing to wave their arms about to get any kind of help. So two really small changes around a really small thing, going to the toilet. So, what else do we encourage the teams to do? We encourage them to come together, we encourage them to share their changes, but we also want to ensure that they're measuring the impact of those changes. And again, it's another time in the room when you hear the groans going around, but what you can see the folk here doing is making paper aeroplanes. And I'm sure many of you have used the paper aeroplane game in your service improvement work to just to show you that actually, if you decide what your measures are going to be, you can really take them on. We also asked the colleagues who were participating in the programme at this time, which was at day 60, to think about how they were going to share this improvement journey, not only across their own organisation, but across their wider network. So they were sent away with designing their communication plan. Pinching with pride is something that we really, really encouraged the teams to do, and we always have time on each of our sessions. This is the day 90 session where we actually, this is still the day 60 session, where we actually got the colleagues to share what three small changes they had made. They pinned them up on their t-shirts and they spent time going around looking at the changes they'd made and how those changes had impacted. And I'll talk to you in a little while about how that looked and how we aggregated that up. But also at this time, we started building on some of the work that we'd done earlier on in the programme, which was around looking at the costs and the cost benefits around this. We all know that injurious falls in hospitals can extend lengths of stay. We all know how expensive they can be. But actually trying to prove to your finance team that this is something you should do and something you should invest in is really difficult. So we commissioned an economic report to support the trusts in order to be able to do this. And we certainly talked to them at this stage about that. And I'm pleased to say that in the next couple of weeks, we're going to publish the findings from that economic report.
Yo, J. Stu and crew, we started this Fallen Madness. Fallen everywhere we go.
Yo,
Black Prez, you know what to do.
Let me get this new thing started. We trip, we slip, we fallin'. On purpose, hit the surface, slightly hurtin', but we all in. We get it on video. Reactions also critical. Everybody fall down, do it with a ball now. Even with a small crowd, ain't gotta get it though.
New fan for the supermarket, J. Stu. Look at all of this you have started. When I went to buy some groceries, I saw people falling head over knees. Running free, honey, please. So sick of falling like I got a disease. I'm falling everywhere randomly, uncontrollable. I can't even handle me.
I'm falling again. Lady, help me. I'm falling again. People laughing. I'm falling again. But this is awkward. That's no way to meet a
party. We trip, we stay, we falling. On purpose.
I'm falling again. I'm falling again. I'm falling again. It's awkward, there's no way to meet a chance. I'm falling again. I'm falling again. I'm falling again.
J. Stu Studios, you know I'm awesome.
This is how we do it.
Show us slow, and all they said. was 6'8", he stood, and people thought the music that he made was good. They lived the DJ, and Paul was his name. He came up to money, this is what he said: "You and OG are gonna make some cash, sell a million records and we're making the dash." Oh, I'm buzzing the club.
This is how we do it.
South Central dancing like nobody does.
This is how we do it.
To all my neighbors, you got much flavor.
This is how we do it.
I'll never come whack on an old school track.
This is how we do it.
I'm kind of buzzed, so
because. This is how we do it.
South Central dancing like nobody does.
This is
nobody
how
does.
We do it.
Oh, it's party time.
This is how we do it.
Straight up coming from the west.
So we get them all to share their success stories, but hopefully what you picked up from the film there was just the multidisciplinary approach. We had the MDT involved in things like bedside vision. They picked up again on the issue around medication review, so pharmacists involved, and also the age-old issue around footwear. So that was just some of the changes that Kent made and we wanted to share with you. I'm going to ask Jo to come back now, and she's going to take us through some more bits and pieces.
So all a bit of fun there, but contributes to that shared learning, which is really, really fabulous. So I want to just come back to the network point that I was making earlier, which I'm sure you've now got a sense in terms of this collaborative, in terms of all those provider organisations that were involved, absolutely sharing, pinching with pride. I'm sure you saw some of can feel kind of some of that energy in terms of that collaboration. But that's no good just remaining in those provider organisations. It's great, but actually to share outwardly and to utilise technology to be able to do that. So we utilised hashtag Improve Falls on Twitter. And here you can see some of the impact of utilising that hashtag to have a greater sharing of that knowledge. On the left-hand side here, you can see a tweet that went out from NHS Improvement, and actually it was the highest recorded number of views of that tweet, I think, within that month, and still kind of just talked about, isn't it, within the social media team. It had 159 retweets, which shows just how much this agenda people are interested in terms of multidisciplinary. And in terms of our own hashtag Improve Falls, it's had over 110,000 impressions. So that's potential reach for those of you who are not aware of the impressions, if those tweets were to reach all those different people on Twitter. So it's had a huge impact in a very short period of time, which shows that power of social media to share some of that learning. And some of that learning is about some of the change actions from some of those trusts. So you can see that it comes out quite large on the thing. So as Zoe said, there were 19 trusts, but 25 change actions. So some of those step changes. It was really interesting to see at some of those events that true sharing in a room and people hugely interested in what somebody else was doing. So the lion and standing BP sticker in notes, a very simple change, but was you know, had lots and lots of interest from provider organisations. And those sharing opportunities at those 30, 60, 90 day events were hugely crucial in terms of those change actions and people pinching with pride. And, you know, I almost look at this and think, wow, what an opportunity if we could share some of these change actions much wider than just these 19 trusts, which is what social media gives us the opportunity to do so. So as we're coming to the end of our presentation now, I'm going to hand back to Zoe to present to you the two final slides in what's next.
So what has really worked, the benefits of working together? Well, when we did the evaluation of the programme, 72% of the participants said the greatest thing of benefit was the working together, the multidisciplinary working and the shared learning. Everybody thought that the process mapping, having groaned and moaned to do it, was really important. They really loved the social movement aspect of it, and even now the collaborative has come to an end, we're still using hashtag #ImproveFalls. And Pinch with Pride certainly seems to be going on and is alive and well up and down the country and has been really important. And that cross-boundary working that we did, that we've talked about today, so not only within our own teams, but also with some external partners as well. So what happens now? Well, the journey for those trusts allegedly ended in May. But what we are now trying to do is through events like this, through our website, and you can see the link there to the website, we're sharing our case studies and our improvement tools. We're starting to share our clinical updates. And we're also in the process of setting up a national practitioner network. And then I guess two other things that have been really important as we come towards the end of this journey is, as I say, I've already touched upon the economic evaluation, which will be coming out in the next couple of weeks. But also, through the power of social media, we managed to connect with colleagues in New Zealand and discover the most amazing falls programme that has been going on the North Island of New Zealand. And we were very fortunate enough at the end of May, beginning of June, to have a WebEx with our colleagues in New Zealand, where we could share international findings as well as the findings that we'd had. So what we wanted to do today was to show you that actually working together in a multidisciplinary way is really important, and do that through the illustration of our Falls Collaborative, which I hope you found interesting. I think we've probably got some time for some questions. Both Joe and I are really happy to do that. Now, because we need to, if people have got questions in the room, which we can start with, if people could just wait for the microphone to come to them, we'd be really grateful.
Thank you.
If not, we can go to the GLISA questions.
I'm just wondering what work's been done potentially with NHS Improvement around engaging AHPs and nursing staff with 7 days, and particularly around AHP?
Yeah, so we started that engagement. So I don't know that you know, I've been in post since 1st of December. The 7 day services programme has obviously been going on way before that. And we started to put in, so the first thing I've been doing is doing some visits with the 7 day services team out to provider organisations to look for best practice in terms of 7 day services. What I've also been asked to do is be part of some of the webinars that have been happening across provider organisations with directors of nursing and other members of the board. So there is an engagement plan in place to support that, but there are still lots more to do on that. One of the things that I'm often asked about is how can we support 7 day services for AHPs, and that's kind of the next challenge, really, is looking at where that's been done really well and sharing that best practice. So I'd be welcome to having more of a discussion with you about that afterwards.
Sounds good.
Just a question with regards to the measurements of the success of some of the participating trusts. Do you collect as well not only the number of false incident but the false resulting to harm? I'm just trying to exclude that this is based on the low reporting rather than measurement of the patient harm itself.
So actually, you mentioned one really good point there, which is one of the activities we got the trusts to undertake before they started the programme was to actually use the Royal College of Physicians under-reporting tool. So we actually got the trusts to look at how many times they did report falls, so that we could actually exclude whether when we saw an increase in reporting, was that because there'd been an increase in falls, or was that because people hadn't been reporting falls previously. Most of the trusts are separating out their falls when they're looking at them in terms of whether they've been injurious falls or not, and through the data that they collect locally, they're able to do that. So in answer to your question, yeah, there's a bit of both. There's a bit of just ordinary falls, and I hasten to use the word ordinary as opposed to injurious falls, and trusts are able to look at the difference between that, and they're utilising that information.
We have got three questions on GLISA, but it's not coming up there as I was told to.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have got three questions on GLISA, but I was told just to press three and they would come up on here, but obviously they haven't. And I don't know how to refresh that, apologies. So I can read the questions out. So the first one is, how did you ensure that no single clinical discipline over-dominated the discussions in moving forward with specific improvement programmes? I don't know if you wanted to start with that.
Well, of course, the nurses always dominated the conversation. No, I think it happened. I can't take any credit for it. I think the fact that we brought the teams together and gave them an opportunity to spend that time together, and part of the way we run the programme is that they have together time during the days on the days they come to us, and it just gave them those opportunities to have those rich discussions at that point in time. The two examples that we've shared with you today, North Cumbria and Kent, are both led by AHPs, which is really brilliant to see. And so we haven't really had any kind of interdisciplinary rivalry, have we?
No, we haven't, but I think what's quite useful to say, you know, not naive about this, is that, you know, when we were discussing with the different provider organisations that came, I think that there is a kind of spectrum of how involved or not involved AHPs and the wider workforce are. But what has been really useful in the collaborative is that it allows to have those open discussions. So where there were provider organisations that perhaps were struggling a little bit more to get their AHP colleagues involved, they could have those discussions with the other provider organisations where their AHPs were on board and saying, well, how do we do that? How can we influence them? Can we meet up? Can you come and have a look? So I think that was really useful for people to have been able to have those open discussions about some of those, you know, potential risks of professional silos. And role modelling, I guess. The two of us role modelling in terms of being able to have those open professional discussions.
Yeah, and I don't know if we've got any doctors in the room, but we had two of the trusts, their work was led by physicians, which was really useful, particularly where some of the sites were finding difficulty engaging with some of their medical staff.
So the next question is, do you think you need budget to implement effective change?
No. A lot of those changes, lying and standing blood pressure, is something that costs absolutely nothing. A number of the trusts implemented the bedside visual tool. That doesn't require anything. A number of them implemented changes around how call bells are used, how frames and apparatus walking aids are used. No, I don't think any trust has overspent or spent excessively as part of the collaborative.
So it's just about thinking differently and doing things differently and ensuring the right processes are in place. And the third question is, how did you decide that 90 days was the optimum number for an improvement cycle? I mean, at the beginning I spoke about process and methodology. So the 30-60-90 methodology is a known methodology in terms of Institute for Healthcare
Innovation.
Yeah. Had a bit of a blocker there. So it's a known methodology. I mean, other methodology can be used, and that's not just one, but certainly that's the methodology that this collaborative use, and there are other collaboratives in NHS Improvement that is utilising that methodology. I mentioned the ACT Academy and their training. Again, they highlight that as one specific methodology, but you can use other methodologies in terms of improvement, and use social movement in terms of improvement and change. So it's only one specific methodology, but it doesn't have to be the methodology that's used.
And again, as part of our evaluation, we asked the trusts how they'd found about it, and a lot of the trusts were really daunted in the first instance that at day 30, day 60, day 90, we were going to expect outcomes. But actually, a lot of them felt that the driver for feeding back to us actually supported them to make changes in their clinical area, and to actually focus on getting, not always getting things perfect, but actually testing a change and thinking, do you know what, after 2 or 3 days this really isn't working, let's try and test and change something else. And this is that pressure, if you want to use that phrase, of those timescales actually help to move things forward. And yes, some trusts were a bit slower to get started than others, but they all finished the journey in a really good place. So I can see my colleague flashing a little sign saying time up. Joe and I are both around, so if anybody wants to pick up any more questions with us over the lunch break, or you were too afraid to shout out in the room, thank you very much, and we'd be happy to do that. So thank you for your time.
Thank you.